Okay, I will do my best. I didn't prepare that to do it in English, so I apologize for that. Yes, the fight against terrorism, that's something that has to do much with human rights, and that's where I would like to talk about a little bit. It is the right to a fair trial, of course, in the first place, that is at stake. And further on, it is on the right to free speech, to the right to organize oneself, freedom of religion, and freedom, just freedom, that's also at stake. When we have it, when we talk about anti-terrorism, after 9/11, the EU has made a framework decision in an extremely short period of time. Of course, because it was already ready, but political impossible to get it through. And after 9/11, everything was possible. So. It was it was accepted what was already prepared by the EU countries. The essentials of the framework decision are the obligations to the different states to criminalize a certain amount of terrorist crimes that are normal crimes, ordinary crimes, with a terrorist purpose, and that's also important, to criminalize the membership of the, or the participation in a terrorist group. What does this mean in practice? The first question is, was it necessary to make this new legislation? The answer is no, because it's all about serious crimes like murder, manslaughter, arsony, taking hostages, and the like. And it was all about crimes that were already crimes in all the member states. No discussion about that. The second question is then, why did one insist to criminalize those special terrorist crimes, to introduce those? I think it's at first place to tell to the US that Europe is a good friend. Second place to tell to the European people that who were a bit scared after all that that governments and that Europe is caring on about them and that they can sleep quietly because the EU is awake. And thirdly, there's a more practical reason, and that is that the definition of terrorist crimes is much similar with the definitions in the United States Patriot Act, that is the act in which the United States reacted on 9/11 on the juridical level. And that means that for extradition purposes, one sought to avoid difficulties and problems. So that's the most practical reason for this framework decision. Does it harm? Yes, it does. In the first place, the introduction of the terrorist purpose of a series of normal crimes that were well known already, that's a step towards criminalizing political opinions. Secondly, by defining terrorism in the law, it's open to the states to make special procedures for terrorist crimes, for the judgments of terrorist crimes, and that's not in the framework decision. There's no obligation to adapt special procedural measures, but it makes the once it is a definition is in the law. It's very easy to make special procedures. And in the Netherlands, for instance, that's what has been done. As to the Netherlands, one must say that Jan van Mon told about a mechanism of EU government to say, you have to the parliaments. You have nothing to choice anymore because it's we have to do it because the EU urges us. That's that argument is not for the Dutch government because they went much further than the framework decision obliged to. Not only by making special procedural rules, but also by criminalizing much more than the framework decision is talking about. Yeah, then we have to ask oneself what all this means in practice. In the Netherlands, we have two, and especially one test case that's still going on. It's not yet finalized. That's against the Hofstad Group. That's an Islamic group of supposed terrorists, fundamentalistic Muslims. Some guys of Islam, Muslim guys, were in an apartment in The Hague that was stuffed with microphones by the secret services, and they were coming together over there, and they made some plans probably, and at the moment they were arrested by the police. They een handgranaat, wat is dat?
Een
handgranaat was thrown outside. So all those guys were prosecuted for membership of a terrorist organization, of a criminal organization for the period before the new legislation was in practice, and for a terrorist organization after the law permitted them. To give you an idea, what everybody knows that this proceeding is going on, but to give you an idea, what is in the indictment, in that kind of indictment of a terrorist organization? One thing it's not accepted by the judges, and but in the indictment was said that the terrorist group, the Hofstad group, had as a purpose to where is it to participate? They participated in an organization with the purpose to prepare or to conspire on the threatening of some member of the parliament being prohibited to participate in the parliament. So it's punishable. It's a crime in Holland to prevent a member of parliament to go into the parliament, of course. That's not strange. To threat to do is another thing. To prepare the threatening to do this is still another thing. To criminalize someone because he is a member of an organization with the purpose to prepare, to threaten someone not to go to the parliament, I think that's rather close to criminalize someone's opinions. This was in the indictment, in the original indictment. It's now, it doesn't play any role anymore because this was too bad for the judges also. On the basis of this kind of crimes as defined in the law, it's possible to think like this. But there were other things in the indictment. That's the incitement against public order. That's already a rather dubious part of our criminal code, but it is inside. So that's one of the purposes of the organization. So nobody did incite, but they were members, supposedly they were members of an organization with the purpose of incitement against the public order. And another purpose of the supposed organization was hate speech, and another was threatening people. One must say that at least in the appeal proceedings for the Court of Appeal in The Hague, I must say that unless the very bad legislation, the Court of Appeal has had a good feeling that this is a question about human rights, and they gave a rather good decision. They said different things at the on the incitement and the hate speech. They carefully checked whether it was not against the right to free speech and the right to freedom of religion, as formulated in the European Treaty on the European Convention on Human Rights, and they carefully checked all that, with the result that most of the examples given by the public prosecutor were not valid because they were against the European Convention. And another thing that's very important is that the court said, being a terrorist organization, that means that we have to look carefully about what is an organization, when are people coming together, an organization, in the sense of this article in the criminal code. And they said an organization, that means that there must be some rules, internal rules, not necessarily written, but there must be, in practice, there must be some rules, and there must be a kind of hierarchy, so that people know that they have to follow those rules. If not, they are kicked out of the organization, or they are punished, or whatever. So, and finally, nearly everybody, because some of the guys were prosecuted for other crimes as well, and the hand grenade and things like that. Of course, but that's not in discussion. But for the membership of the criminal organization, they were acquitted. But the public prosecutor appealed, and now the whole thing is before the Supreme Court. And last week, the prosecutor before the Supreme Court gave his advice. That's the way it works, that kind of procedures. he gave his advice, and his conclusion was that the Court of Appeal in The Hague was much too severe on the point of the organization. He said this is kind of network, and why shouldn't be that an organization in the sense of this article. So we are waiting now for the decision of the Supreme Court. What we can say about the approach of the Dutch judges until now is that not all of them, because there are not all the examples that I could give are that positive as that of the Court of Appeal in The Hague. But the legislation in the Netherlands is terrible, is really dangerous and terrible. But until now, you can say that at least a part of the judges are much more scrupulous and on the point of human rights, and they are respecting the human rights much more than the legislator was in its stupid laws they made. I have a little experience in Belgium, because I participate in the defense of a group, the same DSKPC, about which my neighbor was talking. And they are prosecuted in Belgium, and I participate in the defense of those guys and girls. When you have a look at the Belgium legislation, one must say that it's much better. In really, they only did what was necessary according to the framework decision of the EU. They did not criminalize more than that. They did not take special procedural rules. And they even made
reservations
as to the political possible political use of those articles. So the Belgian legislation is really much better than the Dutch is. But the judges that they are extremely different, because also in Belgium the main thing in that procedure is the participation in an organization. That's a bit different in Belgium, but I will not talk about that. But they are prosecuted for being members of an organization which is against the interests of the Turkish state. And on that indictment, the court in Bruges and the Court of Appeal in Ghent, they have they have condemned the people on for instance on the ground that two of them have given a press conference on another subject. But during that press conference, some journalists were insisting on, they knew something, they had heard something about an attack in Turkey that was mislooked. No.
It failed.
Yeah, that had failed, and to be short, the bomb was exploded too early. And some people died, and the organization, the KPC, had given an explanation of all this and had given its excuses for the casualties. And according to the public prosecutor, talking about this was claiming an attack. That was not true. The attack was not claimed because the attack was had failed, but the whole statement was given in Turkey already, and the only thing that was done in Belgium was translating the Turkish statement into English and French, and talking about that on the insistence of journalists at a press conference on another subject. For that reason, two guys were sentenced to 4 years prison as members of a terrorist organization. One of the other defendants in that case had been a lawyer before, and she had been about her nothing could be proved. The only thing that could be proved was that she was present in an apartment at the moment of the searches, and she has been in that apartment. What she had done there, nobody knows. In the apartment, some false papers were found, some materials to make false papers, and false documents, and some weapons were found. And that was the beginning of the whole case. One woman about who only could be proved that she had been present in that apartment, and they knew that she had been a lawyer in Turkey years ago of a movement that sustained members of the families of imprisoned members or of the DSKPC. And that was the reason to tell about her, that she was member of the organization. And to give a motivation on the punishment of, it was 4 years or so, as I remember well, it was 4 years, and then the punishment was motivated because she was very, very dangerous and fanatic, and where that came from, nobody knows. It was an extreme punishment. It was an extreme decision, and it was only a demonstration of, we want to criminalize everybody who has something to do with those people. The decisions in Bruges and in Ghent were quashed by the Supreme Court, not because of its content, but because the public prosecutor also had tried to choose his own judges, and he intervened in the composition of the court in first instance. And that was a reason for the Supreme Court to quash that those decisions. That was very lucky, because that meant that the case had to be back to a court to another court of appeal to be judged freshly. And that was the Court of Appeal of Antwerp, and that was a totally different proceedings. for the first time they were listening to arguments, and we had the idea that that we were not the only who were whose ideas were sanctioned as ridiculous, etc. Because also the public prosecutor, he didn't get what he wanted always. The result was a decision in which people were convicted. Of course, there was not much much debate about that, and the main defendant had taken the responsibility for the weapons and the false papers. So they were convicted for that. That's to say some of them were convicted. Those whose active role could be proved more or less. Everybody was acquitted from membership or from a participation in a terrorist organization. And what can happen then? That happened. It was this time the public prosecutor who appealed, and then the case was quashed again by the Supreme Court. This time in favor of the prosecutor. And the case was brought back to the last court of appeal available, and that's the Court of Appeal in Brussels. And there it's pending now. And I hoped before I went here to give you fresh information about the verdict, because that was planned for yesterday, but it's postponed, so I can't say you how it will work out, but I think there are signs that they are going towards a kind of compromise, but we don't know. As to the human rights, I have to tell you another story that happened during those proceedings. At a certain moment after the verdict in Ghent, the prosecutor asked the immediate arrest of all those who were free when they were before the court. And after their conviction, the public prosecutor asked for their immediate arrest. And that was agreed for everybody but one. And the one that was a guy who had Belgian nationality, who lived in Brussels at a fixed address and who had work over there. And being the risk to fly, the only reason for the immediate arrest, they couldn't say. It was impossible to follow the prosecutor in that in that thing. So he was not arrested after the verdict, but the prosecutor had something other in mind. And he knew that that there was a meeting of the organization in Holland a few days later, and he supposed that that this guy would go there, what he did. And he informed the Dutch authorities that he was going to Holland, and please arrest him, because I tell later. He was arrested during a so-called traffic control. That was very clear that it was not an ordinary traffic control. It was arranged only for this purpose. And then it appeared that there was an extradition request of Turkey against this guy. And he was taken into custody for the extradition proceedings from Turkey. That couldn't happen in Belgium, because in Belgian law, according to Belgian law, it's impossible to extradite Belgian citizens. So they had to wait until he crossed the border. And they informed the Dutch, who were willing to cooperate. And during that traffic control, he was arrested, and he was for several months in custody, in waiting for his for the extradition proceedings. Fortunately, the extradition request of the Turkish were based on nothing, on the fact, on the same press conference, he was a judge for in Belgium, on a two persons demonstration in the European Parliament in Brussels, where he and his wife, where there were some banners when the Turkish minister held a speech over there. And because he was he was in the Republic of the another extradition proceedings in Belgium against someone of DHKPC. Now, fortunately, the Dutch judge said that those facts were not punishable according to Dutch law, and the extradition was inadmissible, and then he was released again. But what means all this? That the Belgian prosecutor not getting what he wanted didn't have he tried to get him extradited to Turkey, knowing very well that a member of or someone active in the context of DHKPC extradited to Turkey will be tortured for sure, will be punished heavily, and there was no problem for him. He said, "Oh, okay, I can't get his arrest over here, then we do it the other way." And the Dutch government was willing to cooperate, and afterwards some journalists have found out that in Belgium it was a high level decision, has been a high level decision to do it this way. And another aspect of the anti-terrorism. And it's not about the freedom of speech or about the freedom of religion. It's about the freedom and about the right not to be tortured. That's still a bit more serious. Yeah, that's what I wanted to say. I'm.
En dank ik ook mevrouw Pakker. Ik heb een omgeschreven speech naar Engels, vandaar dat ik wat grootmoediger ben geweest op de tijd. Ik vond dat wel op zijn plaats. We gaan nu aan een discussie beginnen en het is misschien wel interessant om even met het laatste voorbeeld van mevrouw Pakker te beginnen, om ook eens te wijzen naar hoe Nederland in deze zaken handelt. Het zal jullie allemaal bekend zijn dat er een Argentijnse piloot op zijn laatste vlucht naar Valencia in Spanje is gearresteerd. Daar zat ook een hele duidelijke link achter, want Nederland wist natuurlijk al lang wat er gebeurde en had hem al kunnen arresteren, maar heeft dat niet gedaan omdat er hoogstwaarschijnlijk geen uitleveringsverdrag was met Argentinië op dit gebied, of misschien wel omdat de vrouw van onze kroonprins de Argentijnse nationaliteit heeft. Maar Nederland is heel slim geweest in deze en heeft de man op laten pakken in Spanje. Er wordt op dit moment geprocedeerd, ook in Spanje. En de vraag is En de man heeft gevraagd om terug te kunnen worden gestuurd naar Nederland om hier eventueel te laten staan. We wachten het af. Maar ook Nederland heeft zo zijn manieren om mensen te laten oppakken met haar achterliggende gedachten. We gaan nu over op een discussie. Ik hoop dat u zich allemaal een beetje heeft voorbereid en een vragen klaar heeft aan leden van het panel. U mag dat direct in het Nederlands en in het Engels doen. Ik wens geen andere taal hier te horen. Ik zou zeggen, wie van u wil het voortouw nemen? Mocht dat niemand zijn, dan heb ik wel een vraag. Kijk eens even.
Okay, I have one question for you. My question is, whether you have some experience in handling some cases related to undocumented workers, migrant here in Haarlem.
Yes.
That's the first question. And the second question to to you, from Germany. I happen to know that comrade from the Philippines, and I would like to know, so what because you said that his case is your oldest case, no? It's about 15 years. So now, what is his situation now? So that's my two questions.
Okay. Well, to start with the first answer, my answer, I have had a lot of experience with undocumented foreigners in Haarlem, and over the years, I have seen that it's going to be tough and tougher to get staying permits for that. But it's still possible if you argue within the courts that we have in Haarlem, and you can have some success with that. It's not every time bingo, but a lot of times we have had in our office a lot of cases. I know also that there are a lot of good alien lawyers in Haarlem. There is also a what we call a union of lawyers that are specialized in alien law and in refugee law, and they have meetings regularly. So if you, for instance, have a problem, you just ask the secretary of the office and they will give you access to maybe the lawyer you need.
Yeah.
Yeah. The situation of my client is the court of the first court said he will not get political asylum and he will not be accepted as a political refugee according to a Geneva Convention. But he we cannot send him to the Philippines because his danger for his life and danger of torture. So. They say you can get what we call the asylum third class. It's under the level of Geneva Convention, but it's in the law. It said we cannot send him back to the Philippines because of humanitarian reasons. Not of being accepted as a political refugee, but of pure humanitarian reasons, because of danger of life and torture. And we appealed. We said no. We want to have the full right of a political refugee. And also the government appealed. They say, oh, the court gave him much too much. He has to get nothing. He has to send back to the Philippines immediately. And the court of the second instance refused both appeals and said, no, it's okay, the decision of the first court is right and it's okay. But now you have the second problem. You only have this, it's the fundamental decision, can he be sent back to the Philippines or not? Now the foreign authority of the city he lives in has to decide, can he get a normal permission to stay, or only this so-called tolerance, mm-hmm. which is only for a few months, and he has restrictions to his his mm-hmm. possibilities to move. He has to stay in Nordrhein-Westfalen. He cannot come to the Netherlands, or he cannot leave North Rhine-Westphalia. He only gets the minimum of money to live, and he is on the lowest level you can keep someone. And now we have to appeal again to court. We want the normal permission to stay in Germany, and I think this the foreign authority of the city he lives in already received a letter from government. Don't give this man the normal permission to stay. We have to be asked, and we don't accept it. And now we have to go again to court, and I don't hope it will last another 15 years to get the permission for him to get a normal life in Germany. Can move, he can get money, and so on.
Okay, thank you.
Some other questions?
Yeah, voor mijn, ik zeg het maar even in het Nederlands, maar wat. Ik vind het hoe dan ook een schande als ik zie hoe mensen beschuldigd worden en dan ook in de gevangenis gezet worden zelfs. En ook nog als ze tot een paar jaar in de maatschappij worden neergezet. In hoeverre is het ook mogelijk om een schadeloosstelling te vragen voor dat soort mensen? Want het is toch verschrikkelijk wat je aangedaan wordt.
Ja. We hebben een claim voor schadeloosstelling lopende bij het Europees Hof, waarover nog geen uitspraak gedaan is. De reden waarom dat zo is omdat we na die eerste procedure, die gelopen heeft van 2002 tot 2007, toen we geconfronteerd werden met de vernietiging van die eerste reeks beslissingen, maar een nieuwe beslissing om op de lijst te zetten, dat we het Europees Hof gevraagd hebben om de tweede zaak te behandelen volgens een spoedprocedure. Dat werd toegestaan op voorwaarde dat we de discussie over schadeloosstelling voorlopig wilden uitstellen. Zodanig dat er eerst uitspraak over de grond van de zaak kwam en pas nadien een discussie over schadeloosstelling. Dus ja, je kan schadeloosstelling vragen. Of we ze gaan krijgen, dat is een heel ander probleem. Dat is absoluut niet zeker. Daarboven, de vraag is natuurlijk, hoe kan je de schade die door zoiets toegebracht wordt, hoe kan je die vergoeden? Want het gaat niet alleen over schade voor hem. Waar je nog in zekere mate kan berekenen, hè, heeft hij een uitkering verloren en heeft al die tijd, daar kan je nog wel cijfers op plakken. Maar het gaat natuurlijk vooral over de imagoschade, de politieke schade die is toegebracht. En ook de schade die is toegebracht aan eigenlijk niet aan hem rechtstreeks, maar aan de hele progressieve beweging in de Filipijnen. En aan al de mensen die daar op een of andere manier mee verbonden zijn. En die eigenlijk via hem, via het label dat op hem geplakt is, tegelijkertijd eigenlijk hetzelfde label hebben opgeplakt gekregen. Dus ik denk dat, ik zou zeggen, de meest aangepaste vorm van schadeloosstelling zou zijn dat de Europese Unie afstapt van dat soort van politiek en openlijk zegt dat ze zich daar vergist heeft. En dat ze terugkeert naar internationaal rechterlijke standaarden. En dat ze opnieuw dezelfde houding aanneemt als degene die, laat ons zeggen, ook in het verleden meestal werd aangenomen door, denk ik, de meeste regeringen in Europa. Dat is, er is weliswaar politieke solidariteit met de regeringen van bijvoorbeeld de Filipijnen, maar degenen die ageren tegen die regering hebben een ruimte om zich vrij uit te drukken zonder daarvoor gecriminaliseerd te worden. Zo was het voordien in de meeste landen en zo hoort het eigenlijk ook. En dus ik denk, de meest goede vorm van compensatie die er zou kunnen zijn, is niet om wat geld te geven, maar is om de verblijfssituatie van José María Sisson en van de andere mensen die in dezelfde situatie verkeren, die te regulariseren. En eindelijk te zeggen, want ook hij zit in dezelfde situatie als als die hier beschreven wordt. Hè. Ja. Hij heeft een getolereerde status. Hè. Dus eindelijk zeggen, kijk, oké, we gaan die status regulariseren. We gaan afstappen van die criminaliseringspolitiek. We gaan erkennen dat er in de Filipijnen een conflict aan de gang is. Waarin wij, laat ons zeggen, de beide partijen de kans geven om zich uit te drukken. Ik kan natuurlijk niet vragen dat de Filipijnse regering de mond zou versnoeren. Dat is niet waarover het gaat. Hè? Maar waarin we erkennen dat er twee partijen zijn en waarin die beide partijen zich ook moeten kunnen op een redelijke manier uitdrukken en hun standpunt over het conflict hebben, dat zou volgens mij de goede manier van compensatie zijn. Hè? Maar daar staan we nog ver af. Hè? Want we hebben nu gewonnen op die terrorisme-lijst, maar het gevecht voor een verblijfsvergunning voor hem, dat begint nu. Hè? Dus en dat is volgens mij het volgende gevecht. Hè? Ja. Niet voor een som geld, maar om zijn verblijfstatus in orde te krijgen.
Misschien kan ik hier een korte toelichting op geven wat het standpunt in deze is van het Nederlandse ministerie van Buitenlandse Zaken. Die zijn geconfronteerd met de uitspraak. Er zijn kamervragen gesteld. En dan wordt er gezegd of er dan misschien nu een verblijfsvergunning gegeven kan worden. En dan krijg je een heel formeel antwoord van de minister van Buitenlandse Zaken. Gezegd, er loopt op dit moment geen aanvraag voor een verblijfsvergunning van meneer Sisson. Met andere woorden, daar houdt het mee op. Terwijl dat helemaal niet waar is, want er lopen nog twee zaken bij de rechtbank waarin om vergunning tot verblijf wordt gevraagd. Maar zo zie je alweer, minister van Buitenlandse Zaken, die geeft er een antwoord zonder blijkbaar overleg te hebben gehad met de minister of de staatssecretaris van Justitie, die wel conform de antwoorden zegt van ik wacht dus op een aanvraag, terwijl er al lang een aanvraag ligt. En dan wordt er ook nog gezegd over of meneer Sisson dan in de toekomst toch niet een uitkering moet krijgen, en daar krijg je weer hetzelfde antwoord op, dat volgens internationale maatstaven het niet is uitgesloten dat mensen, zoals meneer Sisson, toch kunnen worden geblokkeerd voor het krijgen van een uitkering. Dat is een beetje de situatie die op dit moment op de antwoorden.
Het is toch volledige politieke willekeur? Ja.
Eigenlijk is dit hetzelfde als wat ik als de middeleeuwse strategie. Hè? Als je een stad wou doen capituleren, dan legde je daar een beleg rond en dan hield je dat vol tot er geen water en geen brood meer was en dan moest die stad wel capituleren. Ja. Eigenlijk zit je met hetzelfde soort van... Het recht wordt nu gebruikt om eigenlijk dat soort van cordon rond iemand te leggen en te proberen van hem uit te roken. Dat is de enige... En waarom wil men hem uitroken? Ja, omdat er gedacht wordt dat hij invloed heeft in een beweging die zich verzet tegen, onder meer tegen de pogingen van de Verenigde Staten om terug voet te krijgen aan werkelijk dan militair in de Filipijnen zich terug te vestigen. Hè. En dus volgens mij is het helemaal geen toeval dat al die dingen gebeurd zijn op een moment waarop, je weet dat de Filipijnen twee belangrijke basissen hadden, twee belangrijke militaire basissen hadden in de Filipijnen. Clarks en Subic Bay, die zijn ontruimd, zo gezegd, omwille van de vulkaan, de Pinatubo, die op een bepaald moment uitgebarsten is. Maar eigenlijk omdat er een hele grote volksbeweging was voor soevereiniteit en tegen die basissen. Zijn ook een beetje ontruimd natuurlijk, omdat op dat moment die basissen wat minder belangrijk waren voor de Verenigde Staten, omdat de oorlog in Vietnam ondertussen verloren was. En dus als steunpunt voor die oorlog had men ze niet meer echt op dat moment nodig. Ondertussen denk ik dat de Verenigde Staten het plan hebben, niet alleen het plan hebben, maar dat ook proberen, dat ook doen, om zich terug in de Filipijnen te vestigen. Het Visiting Forces Agreement, er is een overeenkomst, er zijn troepen op, Amerikaanse troepen op het terrein. Dus je hebt daar de wil om terug te komen. Als je de kaart even bekijkt, is dat ook niet zo fijn. Dat kan je ook wel begrijpen, welke plaats dat in de strategie neemt. Want als je de Filipijnen bekijkt, dan heb je aan die kant het hele Pakistaans-Afghaanse gebeuren. En aan de andere kant heb je China. Hè? En dus uiteraard een nieuwe strategisch belang. En dus als je dan opnieuw voet aan de wal wil krijgen, ja, dan probeer je natuurlijk de politieke weerstand daartegen op voorhand te breken. En de politieke weerstand, daar zijn ze van overtuigd dat hij daar een rol in speelt of kan spelen. En dus krijg je een hele internationale machinatie waarin de Verenigde Staten het voortouw nemen, maar waarin Nederland helemaal meegaat. Waarin om puur politieke redenen dit soort van maatregelen genomen worden. De lijst, maar ook het weigeren van de verblijfsvergunning. Dat is volgens mij de kern van de zaak. En dat is inderdaad puur politieke willekeur.
Er is nog een
European Court of First Instance decision to take out Professor Sisson from the terrorist listing. We all know that that has been a positive decision, and that the 6 weeks appeal period is already forby. It's finished. My question is, that's it. Is there any legal instrument still available for the states to use, the Netherlands, for example, to reverse this state of this fact?
No, I don't think the decision at this stage can be reversed. Huh? It's a final decision. It's an executory decision, and the council decided not to appeal. Hmm? At some point, my fear was that there would be an appeal to gain time, because there were some signs through discussions and things I heard that as a result of the decision of the European Court in his case, they would try to change the legal criteria to put somebody on the list. The legal requirement to put somebody on the list now is that there must be on a national level a decision to prosecute, to investigate, or to convict for involvement in terrorism. And that's precisely what the European Court said. They said, in his case, you don't have this type of decision. The legal requirement to put somebody on the list is that you have a prosecution, an investigation, or a conviction for terrorism. And there's no such thing in his case. So you've put him on the list without meeting the legal requirements. Now, that can lead for some to a point of view where they say, let's lower the legal requirements. Instead of requesting a decision to prosecute or a decision to investigate, let's say that indications in a legal decision could be sufficient. Some considerations, side considerations in a legal decision could be sufficient. And there was, I know that some people within the European Union proposed to go down that road and to change the legal requirements, to bring it down. The other problem is, of course, that the results, the negative results of the war on terrorism became so clear now, and there is so much resistance and protests against this way to handle the problem, that I think the political climate now is not there. Is not sufficient now to try to even lower the standards. There's a lot of criticism on the lists, not only on the proceeding, but also on the substantial matters. And so I think those forces who wanted to use this decision to lower the legal requirements, which would have allowed to put them back on the list, they lost this battle. I think they politically lost this battle also. And the sign of that is that the European Union said we will not appeal in this case. So it's a final decision. But I mean, that doesn't mean that whenever there is a new situation like 9/11, which might occur, the most reactionary forces that want even larger and less stringent legal requirements to put somebody at least might launch a new attack. They might try it again if we are again at some point confronted with attacks like 9/11 or like the London bombings. So we really have to continue to fight on these questions and to I think to oppose the very logic of the war on terror. Of course we are opposed to blind violence against citizens. Thank you. as progressive people, we can't be in favor of blind, violent acts against against non-combatants. That's very obvious. But the normal criminal law is sufficient to deal with that. We don't need anti-terrorist laws for this. And the anti-terrorist laws are used to go beyond that and to criminalize disturbing opinions, to criminalize political activism, to criminalize legitimate resistance and liberation movements. And so we have to continue to fight that, to oppose that logic.
Thank you.
Yes, you mentioned that they have been trying to pursue this anti-terrorist legislation from 1937. And it's by force within the establishment. Then my question is that who are the forces? Is it possible to characterize those forces? Because European Union, they have now passed unanimously the same rules for every country. But there has been, social democrats in one country, another country is a right wing. So how they make the unanimous consensus about all these issues? And who are? Is it possible to characterize the forces within the establishment who are pro this and who are against this?
Well, that's of course a difficult matter, especially if you want to characterize it on the basis of classical division lines between political families in Europe, because social democrats have been in some cases at the forefront of pushing this kind of measures. So it's not always those who are considered to be the right or right wing who are the worst on these questions. Some right wing liberals are nevertheless very, let's say, they defend classical freedoms sometimes much stronger than some social democrats. Now, maybe one thing we can say is that at some point in the history of Europe, in the previous history of Europe, this anti-terrorist logic was extremely dominant. We have known a period during which, by definition, the action of the state was legitimate, and by definition, any opposition to it was criminal. We have had a period during which the repression was completely based on this concept. That's during the Nazi occupation. So I don't say that all those who are in favor of this kind of approach are Nazis. That's, of course, but that would be, that would not be correct to say so. But what you can see is that if you take this logic and you really take it to the very the farthest point possible, then you get to the system that was existed during the Second World War, where any form of resistance against the state was considered as being terrorism. So it's obviously the most reactionary forces who try to criminalize political opposition through this kind of mechanism. Now, then of course, get all kinds of nuance. Some forces want to go extremely far, some others want to step into this logic but don't go to the very end of it. But it's obviously the most reactionary forces that are in favor of criminalizing political opposition as a terrorist activity. Thies Bracken and myself, we went at many occasions on observer missions to Turkey in the 1990s. At that time, Turkey had an anti-terrorist law which allowed to criminalize all kinds of opposition. It had an anti-terrorist law which allowed to criminalize almost everything, that everybody who simply had the wrong IDs. At that time, the European Parliament very strongly criticized that anti-terrorist law. They said that this was against the freedom of expression, etc., etc., etc. the reality is that at that time already we said, well, there might be a two-way process. Either the Turkish, or either we will be influenced in Europe but by what is happening in Turkey, and which was the result of the coup, of military coup, or it will be the other way around. Maybe Europe will be. Now, it's very clear that the way it went is that the logic in which this Turkish military dictatorship, because in fact it was a military dictatorship, even if it had a civil front, the logic, the anti-terrorist logic used by this military dictatorship in Turkey, finally influenced the situation in Europe. And there's no criticism anymore now towards this kind of situation. They now adopt European legal instruments which are very close to what happened at that time in Turkey and which was very much criticized. So I think you see the shift there. Huh? You see shifting to a much more reactionary approach and a much more criminalizing approach than what previously existed in Europe. Now that we can explain to the Dutch people that you have been not only unjustly blacklisted, that this unjust blacklisting has had very negative effects on the human rights situation in the Philippines, that you have been unjustly arrested 2 years ago, and that the court very clearly said that you were unjustly arrested. I think the basis to convince the Dutch people and the Dutch progressive and democratic movement that the government should now stop doing what it has been doing since 1988 and should give you a normal status, normal residence, a normal social allowance, the right to work, because I think the main problem is also to have the possibility to have an income, not only from a social allowance or not mainly from a social allowance, but to work as a lecturer, etc., to earn your living. And to give you the opportunity to travel and to do the work you have to do in favor of the Dutch people, I think the situation now politically is much better than it was before. Precisely because the Dutch courts said that you are not a criminal and the European court said that you could not be blacklisted as a terrorist. And I think we have to fully, of course we have to wage a legal campaign to try to get these rights. But we also fully have to mobilize and to explain through all possible channels to the Dutch people that the only just decision is to restore these basic rights for you. And I think the situation now is better than before, because it's much more difficult as long as people hesitate and don't know exactly and don't have a decision with the authority of a court saying we looked into this and this was unjust. I think it's much more difficult as long as there is some form of uncertainty about it to make these arguments. So I think now it's the time to use the momentum. Now it's the time to talk to the peace movement, to the progressive movement, to the political organizations, to religious organizations, to whoever is worried about justice in the Netherlands. To get back these three basic rights. So there's nothing automatic, but I think the condition is better than ever to wage a campaign on this.
Okay. Well, something more. I think I grasp your point that we have to do the legal approach still and what you may call meta-legal approach. Taking advantage of what you call the political momentum. I suppose the key term in legal and moral terms is justice. You have been victimized by three governments, specifically with the use of false charges. False charges were leveled against me to deprive me of the asylum, and then to split terms. Between recognized political refugee and non-admitted, legally non-admitted refugee. And then false charge was again made in order to arrest and detain me. And of course, the terrorism charge is a false criminal charge. These things have been going on. And I think to be on good moral ground, you have to expose the falsity of the charges fabricated by the Philippine government, prodded by the, directed by the US government, and accepted willingly by the government that has power to do some certain things against me. So I think that's the main thing to focus on, how false charges have been used against me. And false charges is a human form of human rights violation. That's been the technique, the method for justifying the killing, preparing, justifying, and preparing and carrying out the extrajudicial killings and so on and so forth in the Philippines. Another point I'd like to, I know exactly how I got into trouble with the Dutch government because I got it from a young member of the international.
Can I ask you, please, or to put a question?
Yeah.
Or just give.
My question is: do you think the use of we should be able to expose and hit this the use of false charges, and because you must have a key point in pointing out that justice must be rendered to me. I've been victimized, no? And I think when you ask for some kind of compensation, moral and financial, at the European level, you'll have to show that I have been victimized. So, and one of the non-financial things by which I can be, by which things can be set right, is that I get the residence, and residence would provide the social benefits and also respect for the right to travel and so on and so forth. Those things are interconnected. And then afterwards, we can go after the arrears, okay. No?
maybe you will.
Second time.
Maybe you have to make an appointment with your lawyers. And discuss
I hope that's not a comment on my. That's not a reflection of what I'm saying.
I just want to ask: are there more questions? Zijn er nog meer vragen?
Maybe I just have a short question for Professor Diesbraken. As an emeritus professor of the Maastricht University, have you got the feeling that there are more law students interested in these matters? Have you got the feeling, or can you sense that the Dutch legal profession is actually more interested in these matters?
Unfortunately not. I think that 10 or 20 years ago the interest in those matters was much more lively, and also students were much more politically active than they are now. And I think it's we don't live in a good climate at this moment. It's not a kind of climate crisis, but I don't think that that the legal profession and the students are very interested in those things at the moment. I'm not very optimistic about that.
Satisfied with the answer?
Yeah, because I know, because there is this, there is this. Maybe that's a good follow-up question. What do you think are the factors of that sentiment?
It's a general political climate we live in at the moment. People are thinking about their own career and. Law students are not interested in Yeah, injustice and they are interested in making a career and in getting a good job and but questions of justice and injustice.
Not all students, I can
say. No, of course not all, but the general climate is
it's very bad.
Yeah, it's bad.
We still get letters from young students that want to be a member of our office, or they want to have some years to make a practice. Yeah. So there are still people thinking about this kind of thing. But I agree with Thies Pakke that the situation is quite different as in the time that when I was a student. There was more.
But it will change again, of course. And we have to do something to get it changed. But at this moment, I'm not very optimistic.
May I disagree? I'm sorry. I'm not to be too pessimistic, but I'm quite active in the Dutch human rights community. And I really do have the feeling that young students are interested in human rights, but it's just a difference from society from the 1970s. People are much more into Facebook, into internet, into quick action. And I think it's also in the way you organize strategies to deal with these kind of issues. Maybe people are not interested in a long-term commitment in terms of going to court, etc. But it's also a question of effectively organizing how society is. I'm also president of the Dutch section of the International Commission of Jurists, and I do have the feeling that there are many young people interested in human rights, especially in aliens law. We do attract new people, but we also have to understand that our society is very different from the 1970s. It's not so politicized, but people, I have a feeling a lot of law students, I used to work at the University of Utrecht, I've taught human rights, and I have a feeling that the young people do want to take these courses. But the problem with the concept of human rights is that a lot of Dutch people associate it with something that happens abroad. Mm-hmm. And it becomes a little bit difficult when we talk about human rights in relation to our own society, because it was always something we judged others by. And we talk more about grondrechten or civil rights. So I don't, maybe society has changed from the 1970s. And on the other hand, also with the International Commission of Jurists in the Netherlands, we have tried to lobby in Brussels against some of these developments into criminal law, and we do see progress, even though it's very limited and we can't affect and change everything. But I think we also have to be critical to ourselves and lobby far more strategically with politicians, and also give them, explain it, and I can continue, and I don't want to dominate the discussion too much, but I...
Daar is nog een vraag.
Graag, ja. Mijn vraag gaat meer over Nederland hoor, wat specifieker. Want volgens mij kunt u dat antwoorden.
Nou,
of u kunt dat, ja. Het is gewoon een open vraag en ik wil beantwoorden kort graag. Ik heb een beetje moeite met het samenvatten. De rest vertelt dat er antiterreurwetten zijn ingevoerd. En vooral met 11 september is het een beetje, ja, het is ook een excuus geweest om die wetten in te voeren. Het volk was wel angstig voor terroristische aanvallen en met zo'n antiterreurwet voelden ze zich veiliger. Dat is dus wat er ons is verteld. Hierdoor is er ook geen reactie gekomen van massa om protesten tegen, aangezien het toch ten bate was van het volk. U heeft net verteld dat er, u heeft enkele concrete voorbeelden gegeven over PKK en DSKPC en dergelijke en over professor Sisson. Maar wat ik me eigenlijk meer afvraag is, met die wetten zijn vooral de migranten in Europa potentiële terroristen geworden. Aangezien het echt ook om islamitische bewegingen gaat, maar ook om linkse bewegingen uit Aziatische landen onder andere. En hier is een vraag, want wij hebben een tijd als organisatie een campagne gevoerd tegen de antiterreurwetten. En toen hebben wij brochures uitgedeeld en toen kwam een vrouw en die zei van, oh, is dat toevallig, want gisteren is in onze straat is een Marokkaanse familie. Die zijn gewoon bestormd door de politie. En omdat ze dan zogenaamd een voorbereiding aan het plegen waren voor een aanval. Nou, in ieder geval, dat was dus loos alarm. Maar ik vraag me dus nu echt af, van, wat is dan het effect van die antiterreurwetten op de migranten, maar dan ongeorganiseerde migranten? Wat zijn de cijfers en statistieken? Want waar het mij nu vooral om gaat, is om, om ze wat bewuster te maken van die wetten. En ook gewoon om een beetje een reactie daarop te kunnen te creëren. Maar wat zijn die cijfers eigenlijk? Hoeveel komt dat vaak voor? Wat is het effect op de migranten? Op de ongeorganiseerde migranten?
Ik weet het niet. Ik, cijfers daarover zijn mij niet bekend. Ik weet wel, ik hoor gewoon om me heen dat veel migranten zich hier een stuk minder thuis voelen sinds de, nou ja, met name sinds de islamofobie hier de kop opsteekt. Maar dat wordt natuurlijk gevoed met die, hè, die antiterreurwetgeving is in ieder geval in zijn oorspronkelijke vorm altijd verdedigd met wat er op 9-11 gebeurde en in Madrid en in Londen. He, dus dat is de officiële reden in ieder geval omdat, waarmee dat is ingevoerd. En dat heeft natuurlijk nog het nodige effect met de hele wilders toestand. Daardoor voelen migranten zich minder thuis hier. Maar wat de cijfers zijn van hoeveel ze daar concreet door de politie, door de overheid over worden lastiggevallen, dat weet ik niet. Misschien valt dat nog wel mee. Maar het is natuurlijk vooral dat de hele atmosfeer, zo'n wet werkt niet alleen wanneer de politie hem toepast en wanneer rechters hem toepassen. Hij werkt ook door de hele verdachtmakingen in de media en alles. Ik denk dat daar vooral veel aan de hand is. Maar wat er aan concrete ingrepen op basis van deze wet gebeurd is tegen migranten, dat zou ik niet kunnen zeggen.
Ik heb ook geen cijfers, maar ik kan misschien wel vanuit een praktijkvoorbeeld aangeven hoe zoiets werkt in de mentaliteit van de niet georganiseerde migrant. Er komt iemand naar me toe en die heeft meer dan 12 jaar geleden een valse identiteit gebruikt bij zijn asielaanvraag. Hij heeft hem gekregen op grond van die valse identiteit. Nou, bestaat er in Nederland de mogelijkheid, als je dat 12 jaar geleden hebt gedaan, dan kun je vragen om je nationaliteit, identiteit aan te passen. Dat is een heel gedoe. Veel mensen zitten met dat probleem, want die hebben kinderen en die hebben allemaal die valse nationaliteit. Die kunnen niet trouwen, die kunnen geen originele geboorteakte krijgen. Dus er is belang bij om die 12 jaar af te wachten en dan te zeggen, ik wil schoon schip maken. En nou komt dus het voorbeeld. De man in kwestie is een Algerijn. En die heeft ook nog een Algerijns paspoort. En die zit ontzettend moeilijk om nu dat bekend te maken. Want hij denkt dat ze dan al zullen zeggen dat hij een terrorist is. Want hij, dit is dus een typisch voorbeeld. Want hij moet zich bekendmaken als Algerijn die dus schijnbaar 12 jaar lang in Nederland onder een andere identiteit heeft gewoond. Dus dat zal wel, dat is zijn angst. Ja. Zo werkt dat.
Can I? I'd like to ask a question from my lawyer. Yeah. Friends tell me that since I have definitely won the court decision from the general court, no, removing me from the terrorist blacklist and unfreezing my funds. So they expect that first I will get the social payments back, including arrears. Another is I will get the residence, and then another one, the restrictions on my right to travel would be lifted. No, my answer is to run ahead of you, but to give you a prologue. My answer is it takes some doing.
That's how it always works.
My answer is maybe Dundar can help out on the issue of residence. My answer is it takes some doing to get all those three things. Only the removal of my name from the list and the unfreezing of my small bank account, that's definitely one, but it takes some doing to get those three things. And in general, I would say that from the status of a tolerated alien put on the blacklist, I'm now back to the status of a tolerated alien, no longer on the blacklist. No? So I'm asking these questions for the benefit of friends and other people in the audience. I can try to answer those 3 points, but I think you would have carry more authority in explaining what needs to be done for me to get all those three things.
Well, I think you perfectly summarized the situation. Indeed, from tolerated alien before the blacklisting through a period during which you were a tolerated alien on the blacklist, you're back a tolerated alien not on the blacklist. So that means that there is no automatic situation in which you will recover neither your residence permit, neither your social allowance, neither your right to travel. Because the Dutch government might stick, and what we saw in the questions, in the answers of the parliamentary questions goes in that direction, they might stick to the attitude they took since 1988, in fact. Nevertheless, I think that the fact that you were taken off the list changes to some extent the political situation and the political momentum. Of course, it has been easy the last years for the Dutch government to say, ah, but he's a terrorist, so we won't even discuss these points.
The second thing is, I have a background more sort of in security studies and human rights, and I sometimes have the feeling, if you're interested in human rights, you have to understand how other people in the police officers and people dealing with terrorism think. Because if we just ridiculize them and say, oh, well, they think there's this threat that doesn't exist, you're not really helping yourself. You really have to understand how other people think, especially people dealing with terrorism, etc., in order to really discuss it and to continue in these kind of discussions. Mm-hmm. Next time, maybe invite somebody who works with the National Counterterrorism Agency to really engage more rather than sort of opposing. But I really do respect Chief Spakker very much, and I really appreciate what you have done, but I also want to not be too pessimistic.
No, it's not a matter of pessimism. No. From my point of view, I'm still also looking at what the government is doing in this kind of law practicing. If you refer to alien law, you see that the Minister of Justice and the Parliament is cutting down every time on the budget. So I even understand that as a lawyer you have to have a normal life too, with a normal income. But they are cutting on that too, and that also makes it more difficult for young lawyers to start in, for instance, asylum law, alien law, human rights law, because they have to make a normal living also, and it's hard to work. I stop, but in my job you can't just work 40 hours. You have to work 7 days a week to get a normal income. So that's another limitation. Oké, ik krijg ook last van de organisatie om te stoppen. Ik wil iedereen hartelijk danken, maar voornamelijk, en dat ga ik dan ook doen, onze inleiders. En ik heb daarvoor eigenlijk iets raars gekregen. Ik moet nu namelijk als voorzitter van het panel de cadeautjes gaan uitgeven. Jan, jij ook bedankt. Ik dank ook de organisatie voor deze avond en ik zou zeggen met z'n allen misschien tot de volgende keer en toch maar doorgaan op deze weg, zodat we in ieder geval met elkaar ervoor kunnen zorgen dat meneer Sisson heel snel zijn verblijf vergunning heeft. Ja, daar wil ik het bij laten.